The European Bank for Reconstruction and Development has invested tens of billions of euros in more than 2,000 projects as part of its green transition work. I'm joined now by Odile Renaud-Basso. She's the president of the EBRD. Good to have you, sir, Madam President. I don't need a list of the big and great projects. I do need to understand how difficult it is for the EBRD and for your clients in the post-pandemic world with the energy crisis we're suffering.
No, I think indeed the post-pandemic world is not an easy world, but we see a very strong rebound. And I think that's a positive element of it. After a big shock and the closure of all economies, we see now a very dynamic rebound, which is in a way at the origin of the big spike in energy prices. So there is, I mean, that's the strength of the rebound and the fact that economies, most economies are likely recovering from the big slowdown. This is a very positive news. Of course, there are some vulnerabilities ahead of us. Mm-hmm. One is, the impact of energy prices and the right. risk on inflation. The other one is the fact that all economies are not rebounding at the same pace. Some countries have more people more right. vaccinated than others. This creates some vulnerabilities. And some have also more margin of maneuver to continue to support, in case of need, their economy. So I think there are some disparities, inequalities across countries. But overall, still, we see some positive news concerning the magnitude of the rebound.
One sort of issue is the very purpose of the EBRD. And I mean, I'm looking back, sort of opens in 1991, 30 years ago, with Jacques Attali, who we remember. What purpose does the EBRD serve today that in the multilateral financing environment, why are you still around? Surely there are other ways of private finance that doesn't require sort of an institution like the EBRD, the ABD, the Asia Development Bank, and all these development banks.
No, I think we are intervening in countries where you need multilateral development banks and our kind of financing in order to attract other private sector investors, in order to accompany the countries in transforming, reforming the economies, opening capital of public banks, for example, or public companies, ensuring that the legal framework is conducive for private sector investment and so forth. So, for example, we are intervening a lot in Central Asia, in countries like Ukraine, Caucasus, Western Balkans, Maghreb countries, North Africa. These are countries where private sector development is still a challenge.
It's the European Bank of Reconstruction and Development. I mean, where is your border for where you stop?
I mean, so we are working in the European neighbourhood, 38 countries. It has been, as you mentioned, progressively expanded because it was considered that having an MDB, Multilateral Development Bank, like the EBRD, focusing on the private sector was very relevant and needed right. to support the development of the countries. And we are European also because we have a European, our name is also related to the fact that we have a majority of European shareholders. While we are a multilateral institution, European shareholders represent more than half of the capital. So, and I think in the climate challenge we are facing, right. working between the public sector and the private sector in order to develop private sector projects, I mean, bankable projects for private sector investments will be very important in the coming years. Right. This is what we are doing in the countries in which we intervene.
Good. We'll talk more as we go through COP26. And I'm looking forward to being able to meet and talk to you face to face once, of course, COVID allows these things to happen. Thank you for joining me. I appreciate it.